Funky Politics.
Funky Politics Show.
Funky Politics.
Funky Politics.
Funky Politics.
Funky Politics.
You're listening to Funky Politics, powered by the Kazuki Network. I'm DC, sitting here with our education correspondent for the Funky Pod. You know, we moved up in the world now. We got an education correspondent.
Correspondent.
Brother Luther Mercer. How are you, sir?
How you doing, brother?
Man,
how you doing, brother?
Let's see you sitting in that chair, man.
Well, there was a time ago that you introduced me. You had gave me a lot of titles.
Yeah, I took them off.
And you built me up. Yeah. But you didn't do that this time.
No, I'm gonna let you.
Okay, I'm gonna give myself my own title. Renaissance man, I'm back. We ready to roll.
Renaissance man.
Let's make this thing happen.
You know what? Today we're gonna talk a little bit about education and some of the reforms that are out there and some people in spaces out there. And I remember as a kid growing up in a district, a pretty large district in Memphis. And I remember in the fifth grade, I was just gotten to the school and was really going through a lot of stuff. And I was in the window just tracing this plane flying outside. And my teacher, who happened to be one of not my color, she said, "Boy, you retired or something. Why don't you sit down over there?" And I'm saying to myself, you know what?
Wow.
I thought, maybe, there was something to that. And it hurt me. I'm 51 today. I was in fifth grade then when she said it. Ms. Clarkson said that. And I call her name. I don't have a problem with that. Maybe she's still living. Maybe she's not. I don't know.
Right.
But she said that, and that troubled me. All of these years, that stuck with me.
So you saying that Maya Angelou poem is very true. I think it goes something to the effect of, I can't remember what someone did to me.
Yeah.
I can't remember what someone said to me. But I can remember how someone made me feel.
That's it. And so all of these years. And so in terms of making how we feel, we're going to talk today to a gentleman out of New York, Dr. Christopher Emdin, who happens to be a thought leader in this space of education, right? And teaching young black and brown kids and how they traverse through this system we call education in our country, right?
That's right. That's right. And hopefully he's going to speak more to just your experience and that feeling.
Yeah.
Because when you empower someone through speaking life into them.
Wow.
The power, what does it say? The power of life and death is in the tongue.
That's right.
And the ability within you to transform their lives, I think this brother might be the one.
And I tell you what, that's what we're going to look for, all right? Right here on Funky Politics, powered by the Kazuki Network.
We got the funk. Funky Politics on the Kazukian Network.
Grindset. I'm your host, Cynthia Daniels.
And I'm your co-host, Williams Brack.
So we're going to be interviewing business owners about their journey. What made them leave their 9-to-5 and just go out and create their own brand?
I think sometimes we overplan things and that can kind of cause a delay or setback. But I would definitely say dive in. You know, get your name started. Get your website up. Get your business cards.
Grindset.
Sponsored by Epicenter. Powered by the Kazukian Network. Find us on Apple Podcasts, YouTube, Google Play, and many of your podcast providers.
Grindset.
DC.
We like to get a little funky on this show.
And Doc Ward.
Is it real or is it funky?
Funky Politics.
You're listening to Funky Politics, powered by the Kazuki Network. I'm DC, sitting alongside, I tell you, a good friend of ours is sitting in with us today. That's Luther Mercer from one of the famous Mercer and Mercy firms out of West Tennessee. What's up, Brother Mercer? How you doing, man?
How you doing? How you doing? Thank you for having me back.
Man, I always got to put you with a firm. It'll be another firm next year.
That's fine. And actually, I don't practice law, so it's so amazing. Every time you put me with a firm, I say, well, I don't practice law, but it's okay. Even though I'm a lawyer, I don't practice, but you keep wanting to put me in there. I don't understand.
But you know what? You got to be a pretty good lawyer not to have to practice. I like that. Anyway, look, we're sitting here today, and we're rapping with a good brother out of New York who was just a part of, came down through the South and spoke at one of our universities down here, Dr. Christopher Emdin, who happens to be an associate director of Urban Minority Education Institute at Columbia, a noted author, a thought leader in on the subject of education, and professor. Welcome to Funky Politics, Dr. Emdin. How are you, sir?
I'm doing well. Thank you guys for having me.
Man, well, we're going to jump right into this thing. I know you're sunning and you're enjoying your evening, but let's talk a little bit about the Dr. Emdin. How did you get to this space now that you find yourself in as this hip-hop educator, as I've been told you are, sir?
Yeah, I think, you know, the idea of a hip hop educator is actually not a it's not a recent phenomenon. A lot of folks are like, oh man, you must be the first hip hop professor, and I'm like, nah. As long as there's been hip hop, there have been folks who've been using that art form to be able to educate young people. They may not have been doing it, you know, in institutions or, you know, having gone through getting a degree in education, but, you know, in every single community, there was always that one OG or that one elder who sort of understands the language and the politics that young folks engage with and use that as a way to be able to connect them and really get them to be able to think thoroughly about their lives. You know, on every street corner, there's that one old head who somehow can spit a rhyme or use some, you know, some old saying that connects the young folks. And so my work now as a hip-hop educator is in that tradition of griots within our community. You know, ever since slavery, we've had these folks who are the storytellers who can use metaphor and analogy and narrative and connect the young folks. And so all I've been able to do is bring that work into sort of educational spaces, you know, merging my scholarship as a scientist and then my work as an educator and then my interest in culture, and then use that to sort of construct an identity. But it's something that's always existed, bro.
Wow, that's wonderful. Wonderful. Hey, you know, Doc, you actually reminded me of something that when I was in law school, there was a guy, professor, who said, Luther, what do you think about Ebonics? And I said, what do you mean? He said, well, you know, everybody's talking about this language that's of the streets that now is being utilized as a way to communicate to groups of people who may have not been engulfed in the system. And so I remember that conversation years ago, and I know you do, about Ebonics. And then the idea that what you're saying is that subcultures, is this what I think you're saying, that as a culture here in the community and in the United States, you now have the ability to say this is valued and absolutely, this is how you connect that value. Is that what you're saying?
Absolutely. Listen, bro, even the argument that we had about Ebonics, right, and the discounting of Ebonics by educators and politicians, I make the argument that the reason why Ebonics was perceived as being deficient by folks who had power was not because Ebonics was some subculture that was problematic, but really was a function of the fact that those who had power had to recognize that this is a mode of communication that they were not familiar with, that they didn't have expertise in, that they couldn't engage in. Right. Can you imagine somebody with an English PhD going into the hood and seeing young folks in the hood constructing this sort of newfound linguistic way of merging English plus colloquial language plus slang into this new way of communicating? The reason why they perceived it as negative was simply because they, no matter how high your degree is in English, you do not understand the complexity and the nuance of urban culture and language.
I think what you just said, Doc, I'm going to stop you right there. It's an understanding. See, when people don't understand, right?
Right.
And so we can put you in a subsection here, and you're different now all of a sudden because, well, I don't understand where you're from. Yeah. Man, this is deep, man.
Doc, what you're saying also, it seems, is you're saying, hey, look, just because you don't understand doesn't mean it's wrong.
Yeah.
Exactly. Okay. Exactly. And doesn't mean, beyond even being wrong, and this is where my work really gets a little interesting, just because you don't understand it doesn't mean it's wrong, but just because you don't understand it doesn't mean it's not brilliant.
Yeah, right.
You know, it doesn't mean it's not complex, doesn't mean it's not layered, and doesn't mean that it can't be a path towards understanding the more traditional approaches. So I'm not saying, you know, just have a ball, use hip-hop, and speak Ebonics.
Yeah.
I'm saying understand and value the complexities of these cultural modes of expression, and then introduce young folks to the concept of code switching so that they can value themselves and still understand the discourse of power. And that they can do both at the same time. But to be able to do both, it first requires a valuing of what is perceived to be colloquial.
Can I ask you a question about your journey? Because I know a lot of people may not be understanding of how you got to where you are now. What journey led you? Because you're going through this system just like everyone else. You're defining and coming up with these ideas, and you're saying, wait, hold on, we can do this different. What's the journey?
I came up in New York City. I went to schools where, you know, the culture that I was sort of connected to was not necessarily valued. But I was always a smart kid, but I just never performed at the highest academic levels simply because I thought school was boring. I thought the teachers were whack. Mm-hmm. And the folks who connected to me who were more appealing were those who were more sort of culturally expressive. Mm-hmm. So I went on, I got a degree, undergrad, as a scientist. So I come to this work of education actually as a scientist. I have undergraduate degrees in physical anthropology, biology, and chemistry.
Oh, wow.
I have a master's degree in natural sciences.
Wow.
I did scientific research on the etiology of schizophrenia and some mesenchymal stem cell work. I lucked out and got into college. And then when I got into college, I started realizing, wait, I'm kind of smart.
Wow.
And then I started really sort of amassing all these science degrees. And then stumbled into going back to the hood to be like, man, all the time I was in K-12, they never told me I was smart. I went to college and discovered it. Could you imagine how much better I could have been if I knew this right away from the beginning?
Absolutely.
Let me.
And that led me to start looking at education and looking at science education.
You're listening to...
And then interrogating science education led me to, really sort of interrogating this on a doctoral level and teaching for a while, teaching science, and then pursuing my doctorate, and then, now, being a professor of science education with an emphasis on culture and cultural studies with a leaning towards sociology, but looking at scientific perspectives to make sense of all of that.
You're listening to Funky Politics, powered by the Kadzukian Network. I want to go right back to what you just said. You said you got in college, you got in school, in a university setting, and you found out, man, I'm smart. I mean, think about all of our black boys out there, man, that are cut off at the knees.
Right.
Doc, I mean, they're literally cut off at the knees now, right?
Right.
You're not smart enough, son. You're too dark. You can't make it. You can't make it in college.
Well, you know what? I would like to ask a question, Doc, that's coming to you, just to piggyback off of what Doc just said, but coming to you, Doctor. A friend of mine said he just got back from he's an alternate on the board of directors for the NBA. And so he went to a board of directors meeting in New York, listened to the new president of Beats, because Beats has a relationship now with the NBA. Listened to him talk about the impact that has driven and is America, and that is urban culture.
Absolutely.
He said urban culture has defined Beats. He said we don't market to suburbs. We don't market to these other. He said because the authenticity and the framing of the culture and the economic foundation had come out of and still is even ever growing in America through the urban lens. And so what you're saying, it seems like to me, is that not only have you began, you understand that in an educational framework, that if you can harness that, teaching kids their value.
Absolutely.
Teaching what they bring to the table. And then a kind of, I guess, integrating that within the broader system. Oh, man.
We're on fire.
Oh, man. Transformation.
Well, if we could get that done writ large in all our schools, I make the argument that 90% of the issues that plague not just education, but plague the criminal justice system could be addressed.
Wow.
You know, our people perish for lack of belief in their abilities.
Wow.
And we send our kids to schools that instead of teaching them academic content, also teach them that who they naturally are is anti-intellectual and anti-academic. And by the time a young person reaches the third or fourth grade, they start believing the lie that the curriculum and the teacher told them. And once your subconscious has been trained to believe that you lack the ability to be academically successful,
right,
you start looking for other avenues to express your genius and your brilliance.
That's right.
And this is why we're always brilliant in things that are perceived to be non-academic. But what we usually do in those spaces is bring our academic selves to non-academic phenomena.
Yeah.
So what we're seeing with the marketing of Beats is the same thing we saw with the blues. It's the same thing we saw with art and design and dress. It's the same thing that we saw with jazz. And it's the same thing that we're seeing in education, which is we decry our brilliance on its own terms. We wait for it to be stolen and adopted by folks who have power and resources. And we allow those people to sell that back to us while telling us that we are not brilliant to begin with. And I believe that we're in an era now where in education, we have to reimagine how we teach young folks to not only believe in themselves, but to believe in the brilliance and the genius of their culture. And also start understanding that you can apply that to academic success. There's no reason why a young person who can count bars or create their own recording studio out of nothing cannot be engineers and mathematicians and scientists. It's the same academic or intellectual heft required to do the same thing.
Yeah.
But they just haven't shown or believed that they can't do it. And so my work is reimagining those possibilities. One young person at a time, one educator at a time, and one school system at a time.
You're listening to Funky Politics, powered by the Kazuki Network. Doc, let me tell you, I'm 51. I grew up in a part of the city of Memphis that would people would consider to be the hood, right? But I know a lot of us had this, man, we had this ability to fix stuff, right? And man, I could see young brothers like myself, 8, 9, 10 years, man, we were building stuff. We could make a drum set out of a box. We had some That's rhythm right. to it. That's then right. we go to school. And we'll say something in a class, and we'll pronounce a word wrong, and a teacher, a person in that room that we look up to would say, boy, that ain't how that sounded, and everybody laughs at you. How many of our black boys and girls over the years have been turned off to excellence in education because of something like that that occurred in the school?
Absolutely.
But that we had a natural knack to do.
Absolutely.
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 I mean, I don't want to belabor the point, man, but, you know, oftentimes I have conversations with brothers like you, right?
Yeah.
Like you both. Really educated brothers, you know, lawyers, and who can be in this space now and engage in critical conversation and have the radio show, et cetera. And they will tell me stories like you just told me, about the experience that they had in school that robbed them of the perception of their genius,
yeah.
and they found a way to be successful in spite of that.
Wow.
And I always say, for every one or two of us who were successful in spite of those problematic experiences, there's 10 of us who are unsuccessful
yeah.
because of those experiences.
Yeah,
absolutely.
And for me, if you want to play a numbers game, you know, we oftentimes say, well, you know, if you know these people made it, so if these people made it, that means it wasn't yeah. so bad. And I'm saying, well, 9 out of those 10, you know, are engaged in the criminal justice system and didn't make it.
That's right.
And so we can't use the few successes who made it on their own as a justification for poor schooling.
Absolutely.
And we've never gotten to a point as a country where we've had a hyper-focus on culture. We've had, you know, new initiatives as far as academic standards. We have new initiatives as far as people starting new schools and opening new schools, a new charter school, a new this, a new that. But even as you reimagine standards and new schools, you're still employing the same flawed approaches to teaching and learning, and you're expecting different results. Einstein told us insanity is doing the same thing over and over again and expecting different results.
Absolutely.
Well, we are doing new schools with old pedagogy, which is the science of teaching and learning, and expecting different results. We are rearranging the seats on a sinking ship and wondering why folks are dying.
Yeah.
And we've got to get to a point as a community where we start saying, you know what, enough is enough. Just because I was traumatized by school doesn't mean that a young person has to go through the same process. Let's reimagine this whole thing.
Well, Doc, let me hit you with something, because you're onto something I want to dive a little bit deeper. New institutions, old pedagogy. Let me ask you this. When you're actually having conversations, I know you got a book talking to white people about how they should teach in the hood.
Yes,
but
sir.
What, talk about the strength of having someone that looks like you, having someone from your community being able to educate you. What does that impact have in that inspiration and upliftment? And then how do we translate that into other parts of this educational system?
Oh man, you asked such a loaded question. I'm gonna try to
I got to do it, brother. I had to set you up.
You know what I mean? You
and that's
you
the legal
the heat on that one, that, you
that,
know what I mean?
That was the legal side of it. I had to put you in a box.
So the first thing is this. If you have a person that looks like you who can serve as a positive role model and who understands your culture and values you, it affects your psyche, it affects your academic achievement.
Wow.
And we know the statistics say that young folks of color don't have enough people who represent them in schools. But I want to push a little bit. And
we want to come back.
I also make the argument that if you had somebody in the school who looked like you, who was enforcing a pedagogy of oppression,
mm-hmm.
that it doesn't matter if they look like you or not, mm-hmm. you're just being oppressed by a person that looks like
Thank you, Doc. Thank you for pushing back. Thank you.
And in contemporary education, that's what we have. You know, you have a lot of, first of all, we could use more educators of color. And I say that all the time. In fact, I just did a thing for PBS about a year ago that talked about why black folks have been pushed out of school. And it's essential for us to have folks of color in schools. But we do not need black educators in schools who are serving, and pardon my language and my discourse here, who are serving in many ways as house Negroes in the institution of contemporary schooling to reinforce pedagogies to keep folks of color as slaves within that system.
By the way, if you want to say that again, just go ahead.
I think he just did. Hey, Doc, let me stop you right there. Let me put a pin right there. This is getting too hot. I got to throw some water on myself and on my education correspondent here, Luther Mercer, because you're getting deep, Doc. give me just a minute. We're gonna pay a few bills here. We'll be right back, right here on Funky Politics with the one and only Dr. Christopher Emdin on Funky Politics.
DC,
you've come a long way from a kid in high school to the front cover of a bestseller.
And Doc Ward,
fighting this war against principalities and realities is straight causing fatalities.
Funky Politics on the Katsukian Network.
You're listening to Funky Politics, powered by the Katsukian Network. I'm DC, sitting here along with our very special education correspondent consultant, Brother Luther Mercer, and we've been having a great conversation with Dr. Christopher Emdin out of New York. And this brother's not only a hip-hop educator, he's a thought leader. He's an author. I mean, man, this brother's deep, ain't
he? Look, he's been already mesmerizing us, man, with where he's taking us. He's taking us to a new idea, new thought around how we need to be engaging our people,
yeah,
in a conversation around education.
Look, Dr. Emdin, hey, look, man, Funky Politics owes you a debt of gratitude. Our listeners owe you a debt of gratitude for what the space you helped create and these minds you're trying to build and trying to change in our culture and in our country. We appreciate that, Doc. We appreciate it, man.
I appreciate y'all, man. I mean, the questions already have been so triggering, right? Of thought. So, and I just love what y'all are doing, man. So I'm glad to be here with you.
Man, appreciate it, Doc. You know, I want to pick back up at that last point of what you were making around the system. And if, even when you have the model of people that look like you, you said, doesn't matter. The system will continue to enslave. So can you continue that elaboration around that point?
Yes, sir. I mean, we've learned this from the beginning of time, right? What we've learned, whether we're talking about education or we're talking about life, is that broken people will break people, hurt people will hurt people.
Yes, sir.
And people who are sort of intellectually and mentally and emotionally sort of colonized, once given some power, will only replicate what they've experienced themselves. So if you have an educator who's gone through a traumatic experience in school and came out of it, struggled through it, and got a master's degree or got a bachelor's degree and is not going to go teach, they oftentimes feel as if their responsibility is to put a young person through the same rigors and the same traumatic experiences that they went through.
Wow.
Now, when they were in school, they ain't like it.
Right.
When they were in school, it turned them off.
Right.
They struggled through, but they ain't going to tell the young folks that they struggled through to make it. Yeah. But they will reinforce those same kind of problematic practices on young people.
Okay.
And so what we have to do is sort of break this cycle and also operate from a place of honesty. If folks of color were really honest about what their expressions were like within schools that did not value them and said, you know what, I ain't really like it. I ain't like that lady barking at me and yelling at me. I didn't like the fact that my teacher told me I wasn't anything, you know, all these years of my life. I didn't like the fact that I had to scrap through and battle through just to make it while I knew a young person in another school down the hill was being told how brilliant and genius they were. And we're honest about our own experiences, then we would not replicate those same processes on the next generation.
That's right.
But right now, we get old too quick. Can I elaborate?
Please.
We graduate and turn 25 or 30, and all of a sudden, you want to be a person who's like, well, look how their pants are hanging so low. Look at the way these kids are talking.
Right.
Look at the way, you know. And we at 35, or 40, or even 25, when we should start really recognizing that you were lucky enough to make it on the other side. You were in shot, in jail, in prison. You kind of made it out. Rather than say, thank goodness I made it out, how can I help another person to be able to have an easier way?
Right.
We start demonizing young folks for the same things we did.
Oh, wait, look.
If you're honest with yourself, when you were 13, you made some mistakes.
Yes,
you were listening to the music you like.
Right.
You engaged in some activities you weren't supposed to engage in.
Right.
So how dare you demonize the next generation for something you did yourself?
Doc, I appreciate you, and I'm coming with you on this. You now are at Columbia. You now at an institution that is a part of a system that has continued to perpetuate some of the outcomes that you're talking about.
Absolutely.
Mm-hmm. Mm-hmm.
Where are you?
And this is why I always say to folks, I'm in that space transgressing by my presence and my work.
Okay.
You know what I mean?
Yeah.
I think that, I remember I was giving a talk once at a university. It was an HBCU, and a brother raised his hand. He got real brolic, you know. And he said, "Well, if you care that much, why aren't you at an HBCU?" And I said, "Brother, maybe you need to be at an HBCU, but some of us need to be in these spaces and pushing back against the norms in those spaces to help us to be able to reimagine them."
Right.
I think we all have our calling and our causes. But I know that when I walk into my institution, I ever perceive Teachers College of Columbia, and I've had fellowships at Harvard, and I get invited to speak to at the most elite spaces. I don't shrink myself in those spaces.
Okay.
Right?
Uh-oh. Yeah. There we go.
That's
right.
You know, right. Now I speak as unapologetically there as I do with you.
Right.
Because they value me for a very particular skill set. They value me for my science background. They value me for my doctorate degree. They value me for different skill sets than what I bring.
Right.
So when I've entered into that space, I now fully blossom as my academic self. I also consistently bring young folks of color from the hood into those spaces,
yeah,
and have them be forced to be able to engage with us on our own terms.
Okay,
and,
okay,
know,
Doc.
Say, look,
Doc, wait, hold on, because I want to hit something. I want to hit a point. Du Bois talked about transformation. Baldwin talked about transformation. There's others that we can go through. I remember watching the Oxford discussion where Baldwin and Buckley,
yes, sir,
gave that debate. The praises that the Oxford Union gave Baldwin for his argument, the celebration of what you're talking about right now for you in that space where people value, but yet the system continues.
Yeah.
Yes, sir.
So we got to do something different. I'm not saying that you're not directly on and you're not bringing value to that. We all know that. But what we're seeing is that they will take greatness like you. They'll look at it and they'll say, wow, let's dissect this greatness. Let's bring that greatness in here. Then that greatness is challenging the system. Oh, okay, make a point. He pointed a fallacy. Let's fix that fallacy. Or let's trigger a change in that fallacy so he can't make that argument. Okay, next. Keep going. And then, as we've seen in eons and eons of time in this country, greatness, they'll use it, and then they won't change. What can we do, Doc?
By not making it about ourselves.
Okay.
This is why I chose to engage in the work in education. Listen, I Chris Emdin does not want to be a hero. Chris Emdin wants to be a person that uses his presence to be able to transgress against established norms and oppressive practices, but I also want to be able to create a new cadre of young folks to be able to deal with that. See, what happens when in the Baldwin era and the era where you'd have Malcolm X go to give speeches at these sort of really lofty academic spaces, that it was really about the singling out of individual brilliance as a way to be able to make the argument of sort of exceptional Negro narrative.
Exactly.
Yeah.
And I think as long as we do that, we can't win.
Okay.
So for me, I do a project, for example, in New York City, and I actually am contemplating bringing it to Memphis, man, called Science Genius.
Guess what you're going to do? You're going to bring it to Memphis.
Yes, sir.
You're going to bring it to Memphis. I'm going to hold you accountable
on
that.
And the Science Genius, what we do, brother? We literally bring a bunch of young people from the hood,
okay,
who know how to rap.
Okay.
And we say, listen, if you're real nice at rapping, you need to be able to write some raps about some academic science content.
Wow.
And if you can't do it, that means you ain't a nice rapper.
Okay.
I mean, we challenge them on their own terms.
Okay.
And then we have them battle each other around science content.
Mm.
And then we identify, like, literally a traditional hip-hop battle, but changing the subject matters. We don't want to hear nothing about no bees and no hoes and no money and no whatever.
Yeah. Right,
if it's about the bars, show me what you got.
Right.
And what we've done is we've reimagined for them their perceptions of self as academic.
Mm.
And now I got 45, 50 young folks who see themselves as scientists. So if somebody wants to pick off an Emdin, they can't pick off 50 young folks who now have been awakened to their own genius. The reason why we've always been battling the same systemic oppression is because we've not set young folks' minds and souls on fire collectively to be able to rush the doors of the system and reimagine what it is.
And
as long as they're playing games of 1 versus 100,000, and not one of recruiting the army to be able to see their own genius and work, we will lose.
Look, Doc, you're listening to Funky Politics, powered by the Kazuki Network. You know, let's go there. I think the point you just made about those hundred, about those kids right there, if you can take those rap lyrics and you can make them about something else. Now, check this out. I was just about to ask you about the urban, and we talk about the urban child. Look, let's talk about brown and black and brown children. And how they fit in this ed reform piece. And see, what you just told me was a piece that goes into ed reform. Am I not right, Luke?
That's right.
You know, the systems or the narrative that you've just placed before us, how we get young people to think differently about the circumstances. Look, I don't have to rap about girls and about this and about that.
Right.
Man, I can put something else that'll be just as deaf, right?
Right. But I think he mentioned something else. you're putting in there these rhymes and other, but you're showing that they're valued.
Exactly.
See, it's one of the things. One of the things I think you hit upon earlier, Doc, that has been ringing in my mind. And actually, I you don't know this, but I've been searching through the internet because I'm trying to figure out. I've got something in my mind. You put it in there, and I can't figure out what it is. But in that, what you've said though is the value that we now have in human dignity,
Hello.
And the human experience. That value, if you can awaken that within our community, to get back to that place where Sidney Poitier said the rise, I believe he said in Measure of a Man, he said the rise of the black community will come out of our integrity and character.
Yes, Brother Garvey. Yes, sir.
There it is. So the idea is, okay, if we now know, you're saying you're using this vehicle, that's powerful, brother. You're going to make me cry. That's what what's going
to
happen.
And so to replicate this, though, Doc, I mean, this is a part of that. We talk about ear reform. We talk about this. We talk a lot about children being in classrooms in front of people who don't look like them. But you just brought up there are people that these children are in front of that look just like them, and they're still with the, I don't want to use the term with the boys in the street, but you know, they still with that stuff,
stuff.
Because like you said, they can't, man, a teacher didn't like me, now I'm going to oppress this child.
Right.
Why don't I show that child love? I want every child in my class to make it.
But what he said earlier.
Dark brown, I want you to make it.
Get what he said earlier, though. He said, broken people what?
Hurt people every day of the week, don't they?
Come on now.
We hurt people, man.
Healing, man.
We still healing.
Community healing. And even this idea of reform. And I just want to interrogate that for a bit because y'all brought it up.
Yes, sir.
When we talk about ed reform, we also have to ask ourselves, who is doing the reforming?
There it is.
If you're expecting someone who's unaware of the nuances of culture or doesn't see the brilliance of the population as a person who's reforming, they're not going to... Look, a person might be charged with reforming the system, and all they end up doing is reforming the system.
Let
me break that down real quick.
I like that.
Reform is perceived as an improvement about what is wrong or what is corrupt.
Right.
And that is what we use as our ed reform. But to reform, if you break those words up, means simply to form again what already existed.
Mm.
So you can have somebody with an ed reform narrative with a reformation of existing problematic practices practice.
Wow.
So, you know, when folks tell me they're an ed reformer, I always ask them questions about what their philosophy is. If your philosophy is in that something is inherently problematic within the community, then even though you have an ed reform philosophy, your practices are going to be flawed and you're going to form the same problem again.
Wow. Wow.
Well, you can do ed reform work by looking at an asset-based approach to instruction, meaning I don't look at what's broken in the community first. I look at what is operational within the community first. Mm. And I use what is successful within the community as the anchor of my instruction.
There we go.
So don't reform me, because your reforming of me means that you inherently perceive me as being corrupt or unsatisfactory. Mm.
Wow.
Help me to be able to form an approach to education that reimagines the whole entire system. Well, and that's a very different conversation.
Hey, you know what, Doc? You reminded me of another conversation. Another conversation about the system. A guy said, Luther, we got to fix the system. I said, fix the system. What does that mean?
Yeah.
He said, well, we got to fix. I said, you are saying that nothing's wrong with the system. That you're saying that we're going to fix it, meaning there needs to be tinkering, or there needs
that's
to be some new, no, there's just a gap here. No, the system itself is the problem. And so what you find in ed reform, and I was in ed reform, I worked for the Tennessee Charter School Center one time. I was policy and lobbying for Tennessee Charter School Center. And in charter work, when I was leaving, one of the challenges was we were talking about things around quality. We were talking about things around where we need to go. The charter schools were starting to replicate the very idea and problem that we said they were set up to address.
Exactly.
Wow.
And so I said, what are we doing?
Exactly, bro.
Moving chairs on the deck of a ship.
Me about that, brother, is that oftentimes parents who are uninformed, they think that just because something is new, better.
There it is.
It's shiny.
And so something new comes in, and they make it pretty. You know, sometimes you wrap it up in a new uniform, or a nice building.
Shine it up, Doc. Shine it up.
Shine that thing up, and then you look at what's going on in those spaces, and you got the same problem.
Wow.
It's unfortunate because in many ways, in some instances, not all, you know, some folks are making money.
Oh,
you are making money out of convincing folks that they should drop their diamonds in search of cubic zirconias.
Right.
And it's such a gut wrenching thing when you know better, because you see a parent who wants better saying, "I'm gonna send my kid to this place."
Right. Right. Right.
And it's like you know, look, we might be better served keeping them home. And you know, I hate to say this sometimes, or you might be better served starting your own spot with folks who believe in what you believe in.
Yeah.
But if you leave, Malcolm X said this best, if you leave the education to your children, to your enemy, do not be surprised if they end up as broken men. And that's what we do today.
Oh, El Haj Malik.
Look, let me stop you guys right there. You guys are too hot of here. We got to take another break here, folks. You're listening to Funky Politics right here on the Kazuki Network. We got Dr. Christopher Emdin. Are we rapping one? And let me tell you something. He's more than a hip-hop educator, man. Brother, yes. You are the educator. Are you sure you're not Betsy DeVos's boss up there, man? Let me tell you. Brother, you
that's
got this thing down, man.
Hey, look.
We're
going to have a conversation.
Oh, boy. We're going to get into that piece. We're going to get it because we want to talk about some solutions next.
DC and Doc Ward on Funky Politics. Griffin on Jazz.
This next gentleman we're talking about has an unforgettable voice.
My sugar is so refined.
Jazz was the happiest since he went to my school.
Oh, really?
Yes, he's not an alum because he didn't graduate. He has some gigs to do.
Griffin on Jazz on the Kazukian Network. Kazukian. Riffin' on Jazz.
When two friends get together to kick it
about jazz, it's called Riffin' on Jazz.
Catch us Riffin' on Jazz every week right here on your favorite broadcast or podcast platforms.
Riffin' on Jazz on the Kazukian Network.
Kazukian!
Politics is what we do. We just make it funky.
Back with you here on Funky Politics on the Kazuki Network. I'm DC, sitting along with Luther Mercer, who happens to be Funky Politics. We're going to call you the education correspondent / guru guy about town.
Oh, okay.
I mean, I don't know. I'm just throwing some stuff out there, guy.
Get that brother some more titles, man. He's bringing that heat.
Man, yeah. He put it on you and me. He can't be over here working, man. He can't be writing notes down and stuff. Anyway, we're talking to Dr. Christopher Emdin out of New York, Columbia University, thought leader in terms of education, especially urban education, education in general, a noted author. No doubt, you're on the radar, Doc, somewhere. Somebody need to be looking for a commission of education. They need to be looking for someone who can transform systems. You know what I'm saying? And we talked about fixing. Don't fix it.
No.
Fix it. I mean, these things, you can't fix these things anymore. Change the tire. That's fixing the tire.
We're talking about a revolutionary change. We're talking about fundamentally new system, new framework, better outcomes.
New approaches. I mean, yeah, that's right. I mean, just complete new approaches. If we've been walking down this street and that same hole is there and we fall in that same hole every day, we might need to change sides of the daggum street.
Yeah,
man.
We've been doing it for too long, brother.
Well, one other thing I want to interject on this. Today, I actually left a conference. Inside that conference, they showed 40 years of data around the needle in Memphis dedicated toward philanthropy, education, other things. Hadn't moved.
Get out of here.
Hadn't moved.
40 years of philanthropy.
In the city. Philanthropy, economics.
Yeah.
All the things that have been brought to bear since the 1980s.
To address poverty, no doubt.
Well, yes, to transform an economic development in this city. The black community hadn't moved.
Wow.
Black community. It's just the philosophy is so flawed, man. I hear numbers. You know what bothers me about those numbers, brother?
What's that?
Is that somebody will use those numbers to reinstill a negative perception about those who have not been successful.
Yeah,
that's right.
So rather than say, y'all threw all this money at this problem and the issue didn't get fixed, they'll say, we threw all this money at the problem and those people didn't get better.
That's right. Now,
you see what I'm saying?
What's wrong with those people?
It's important for us to really transform our frame. If you're throwing money at a problem and the problem hasn't gotten better, it's not because the people you're throwing the problem at is inherently problematic. It's because you spent your money on the wrong thing.
That's right.
And all you're spending your money for is to make yourself feel better.
That's right.
Because you're not really truly invested in listening and addressing the problem. I tell my educators all the time, And although we like money and it helps us to be able to get things done, I don't need a multi-million-dollar grant to be able to transform a classroom.
There it is.
I ain't no willing educator who believes in the power of young folks.
Where it is. There it is.
You know
there
I mean?
It is.
And it's a matter of keep your money and do good work. Look, and just sidebar, the education of folks of color in this country
yes.
was we were doing quite well before the forced integration of schools.
That's
you,
right.
know, you know what? Let me just chill today.
Yeah, no.
You need to
stop.
Bring, hey, this
don't
is
you
funky
stop,
politics,
I'm coming back with that question. If you
this
stop,
is, this
I'm coming
is funky
back.
Politics, man.
Let's go.
Okay,
let's go.
Listen, bro. We were doing okay in schools before we went to integrate schools, and this is not to say that the integration of schools was a problematic practice and we shouldn't have done it. But the reason why we chose to integrate schools is not because we were doing poorly in our own schools. It's because the other schools, under separate but equal, had better resources.
That's right.
We were running to schools with white folks in them because they just had cleaner schools and better textbooks.
That's right.
And under separate but equal, they said it was separate, but we had unequal practices.
Right.
But we ran to those places to get better resources. Yes.
That's right.
But we didn't get better instruction.
That's right.
We didn't get better self-confidence. In fact, what we got in integrated schools is a more direct assault on our personhood and our humanity.
Hey, Doc, I got to talk about something. You mentioned
yes,
it is integration. I was told once, integration is a psychological phenomenon. Mm. Desegregation is a physical phenomenon.
Mm. Yes, sir.
There was never integration because the idea of us collectively taking the strengths of each group to create a greater whole was never that.
Okay. Yeah.
You will
yes,
assimilate
yeah.
into the whole, but you will not integrate into the whole. The second thing is when you were mentioning philanthropy or economic development, any of those things around why this hasn't moved and changed, I told someone one day, we have developed a system that services the problem, but is unwilling to deal with the systematic issues that create it.
Absolutely.
Why? Because the very people we're asking to change it are the people who vested
that's
in
right.
it.
Absolutely.
They the ones empowered by it.
Well, Doc, let me ask you this.
So give it to us, Doc.
Let me ask you this real quick, and then I'm following up on Luther here. First of all, you're listening to Funky Politics on the Kaduki Network. How do we take the easy fixes? How do we fix this urban education piece we've got out there right now? This narrative. What are some of the easy fixes out there, Doc?
Brother, we solve this problem one classroom at a time, and I. You know, we oftentimes think that we need to do these large, grand, lofty, multi-million-dollar initiatives and grants. The way you do this is you instill a new philosophy for pedagogy in the classroom. And most importantly, you got to give teachers, like the conversation we're having now is important for us to have our eyes open. But you got to give teachers practical and tangible things that they could do in their classroom tomorrow to help them to reimagine their relationships with young people. Like literally changing the curriculum to involve some time for young folks to be able to express themselves more through art.
Mm.
Simple thing. Mm. Engaging in conversations with people from young people in classrooms about how they're experiencing the classroom and have them design the curriculum. A simple practice by identifying somebody who was unsuccessful in school and is out there in the community to come and talk to the young folks about the outcomes of their poor decision making. You think a teacher who don't look like me or a teacher who look like me and is oppressive is going to convince me to do well in school when there's somebody who's in the community who did not do well can tell me a more authentic story?
Keep going.
Focusing less on credential and more on compassion.
Well, you know what the problem with I was at a talk, Federal Reserve. Guy says, everybody keeps talking about education is the answer. He said, but the very people who are saying the education is the answer has no education.
Well,
they've got nepotism.
Absolutely.
They've got privilege.
Absolutely.
They are put in
our
places.
Our Secretary of Education does not have a master's degree in education.
There we go.
You know what I mean?
There we go.
Yeah.
But guess what they do? They offer opportunity and conversations around, hey, you know what? You got potential. You got potential.
I like that term. Everybody's got potential.
Yes.
You're listening to Funky Politics right here on the Kaduki Network.
Doc, what's the solution though? I want to get back to what Doc said, but I want to talk to you, Doctor. What's the solution?
Solutions are teacher training.
Okay.
Really going into schools and reimagining how we prepare our teachers for teaching young folks of color. I think that we have to have a movement of occupying schools, having people from within the community. See, if we are apathetic about our engagement, I tell parents all the time, just get five other parents and sit in the school every day, because people will treat your child very differently when your presence is felt. I think it's creating new models for what leadership looks like in school. I think it's redesigning curriculum to focus on things like hip-hop and focus on things like art and focus on things like Black history as an anchor of instruction. You know, I was surprised. I mean, I was in Memphis the other day, man, and I went through that museum, the Civil Rights Museum.
Yeah, yeah.
And I said to myself, is there a curriculum that is mandated in every school around the topics that are in this museum?
No.
The answer was no.
No, unfortunately not. No.
And I'm saying, how are you going to teach a young person to be empowered if they don't know their own history?
Well, you know, you talk about this curriculum here. And I used to do a little stuff with the Public Defender's Office, and we adopted one of our schools here some years and years ago. And one of the curriculum modalities that was assigned to that school was the Little Red Schoolhouse. Have we gotten to the point now where we come up with all of these particular curriculum modalities where I got Little Red Schoolhouse over here, another part of the district I've got the Cheney system or whatever. Have we tied the teacher's hand so much that they can't talk to kids anymore about things in life during the day? They're always using this white space or this whiteboard. Now, man, I remember the chalkboard back in the day.
Right.
You know, where you had to go up to the chalkboard and you had to show what you knew in front of your classmates.
That's right.
Is there anything wrong with that type of instruction anymore,
no.
Doc? And again, have we tied those teachers' hands?
You know, I always say this. And I'm an advocate for sort of more progressive approaches, et cetera. But I always say, if you can't teach a young person simply by your voice and your words, you certainly can't do it with an iPad and a smartboard.
There it is.
Those things are supposed to be assets to make the work easier that you can already naturally do, not a way to be able to sort of be a replacement for the best instruction.
Mm.
So that's number one.
Mm.
Number two, we have tied the hands not just of the teachers, but of the administrators and of the students. In this era of outcome, we test prep kids to death about their outcomes on a test, and we disengage them from being successful on the exam before the exam even comes.
Wow.
You know, we're such a factory model based approach to teaching and learning that we don't realize that, look, if I convince a young person that they're a scientific genius, they will spend time on their own trying to learn some science
to be
able to supplement that fact.
Yes.
That's right.
Rather than disengage them through my science test prep.
Mm.
We need a roundabout approach to the instruction.
Mm.
And we don't give educators the space to be able to do that work.
Right.
Look,
hey, Doc, you know what?
A real quick example, y'all.
Okay, please.
A real quick one. You know, I was working in a school here in New York City, and it was a special education classroom. And the project we did was quite simple. We were going to convince those kids who were in a special education classroom that they were not special ed, but rather, it's an age-old research practice. We just replicated it. And we told those kids that rather, they were in the more genius level classroom.
Mm.
And at first, the kids said, no way, we're in a genius classroom. We was in special ed last year. And we somehow distributed the classroom and said, yeah, but out of the kids who were in the special ed class, we identified those of you who express a certain level of genius. And so you're in a genius level class. And it took 3 months. We didn't do any content. It took 3 months. The kids were already in the special education class, so we already knew that they were not going to do well. The school already said they're going to fail. So we spent the first 3 months, September, October, November, on convincing those young folks that they had a different form and level of genius. Now, we spent December, January, and February introducing them to the science and the math content. And in March, we had them take the test. And we compared the outcomes of those kids with the kids who were in the regular class, and those kids performed better than their peers.
Wow.
And what I'm saying to people is this, and I don't know why we can't get this through our heads, that if you allow young folks to believe in their brilliance and their genius, they outperform their counterparts, and we get so caught up on this test prep nonsense without recognizing the person who designed the test prep is the same person who designed the test.
Wow.
And if they had any intentions of everybody passing the test, you would not. They would lose half their business of test prep.
Oh wow! Oh wow! Oh wow! Hey, you know what, Doc? You reminded me of Dr. Ken Robinson. You know Ken, who
yes,
and the discussion over the factory system. but also the discussion over genius and the idea that we have basically, by the time these kids get to a certain age, we have processed and socialized and structurally educated them out of their genius. That's what you're telling me. You're telling me we've educated people out of their genius, saying, by the way, you didn't pass this test, so therefore, guess what? You don't know nothing.
We've sucked the hope out of them.
Carter G. Woodson was telling us this
miseducation
eons ago, and no one listened. And I think the reason why, you know, and why no one really listened to this philosophy, which we know is right to do, was never coupled with practice. And this is why, you know, as a researcher and as a scholar, you know, I want to be able to, I love going to talk to educators and saying, hey, this is what you could do in your classroom tomorrow. I mean, you know, the book for white folks teaching the hood, by the way, it's for white folks teaching the hood and the rest of y'all too.
That's right.
I don't want y'all to forget the and the rest of y'all too. So the and the rest of y'all too are the educators of color with the problematic practice.
There we go.
But I also want to be like, tomorrow you can go into your classroom and do co-generative dialogue. Structured conversations with young people where they give you feedback on the instruction and you allow them to be able to change the teaching practice, and then you see what happens tomorrow. Like tomorrow you can go and do co-teaching where you take a couple young folks who may not know content, you have them design a lesson, and you give them grades for their design, not the learning, and then have them go teach to their peers and give them grades for that. It's like, you know, I want to couple this work with practical things to do. Why we've not moved the needle is because we push philosophy without practice.
Hey, Doc, I got
something. We push theory without practice. And so this new frontier is to do both.
I got you. I love it. We got a short time remaining, but I want to say this. When I become a billionaire, when I build the private school in the community that needs a leader, and we endow it, we coming for you.
I'm with you, brother. I'll be there with you because I know you got the right philosophy. And I've been pushing this work. Let's get it done. And must I say, brother?
Please.
I love the fact that you said, when I become. And I think that's one simple thing that we don't do for our young people.
Man, what?
That's it.
Man, what?
That's it.
That idea. So when you're in the first grade, I'm saying, so when you graduate college, this is what you're going to do next.
Right.
When you make your, you know, we've robbed them of the opportunity to be able to even dream, man.
That's right.
You know what,
that's
Doc? Let me stop you right. You remember back in the day when we were kids, y'all, and we would stand outside and we say, that's my car. It's simple as that.
That's my car.
That's right.
I mean, that's my car. It's, you know, that's my house. Remember that? You drive down these neighborhoods.
I remember, brother.
It's the same thing.
Mm-hmm.
And if you suck me of my dream, you suck me of my hope.
That's it.
What else I got left, man?
What else?
Hey, Doc, tell us about, you got a couple of books out there. Folks need to get to you. Give us a website. We need something from our listeners. Want to know, how can they see, how can they reach a Dr. Christopher Emdin?
You know, a couple things, man. And for everybody who's listening, I just want to say how much I appreciate you guys listening to this conversation. And I know we're taking off soon, brothers. I appreciate y'all and why you're doing this. But the easiest way to reach me is through my website. It's just my name, www.chrisemdin.com. That's chrisemdin.com. Also, I want to say every Tuesday night, 9 p.m. Eastern, I've been doing this every Tuesday for the last 7 years. You know, when you talk it, you got to walk it.
Yes, sir.
I am online with this hashtag. The hashtag is hashtag HipHopEd, HIPHOPED. And every week is a free online conversation with educators, parents, young people, and stakeholders in the community about hip-hop culture and education.
Wow.
And it's free, and it's online on Twitter. My handle on Twitter is at Chris Emdin, so at C-H-R-I-S-E-M-D-I-N. I'd like to implore everybody to pick up my book. It's for white folks who teach in the hood, and the rest of y'all, too. You can pick it up on Amazon or BarnesandNoble.com. And the book outlines a lot of my philosophy as well as my practice. It's a readable book. We got stories and narratives, but also things that educators and parents can do every day. And I'm also on, you know, other social media, you know, Instagram and Facebook, et cetera. But, you know, I'm always open to engaging conversations as long as it leads to a revolution in education. We got a lot of work to do.
Let me tell you something, Dr. Emdin. You should be leading the revolution in education in this country. I'm going to tell you that right now, Doc, all right?
Thank you, sir.
Would you please come back? Please come back. Because when you lay it down, you get it right. Because that's what we do on Funky Pause. We try to keep it real. We try to keep it right. We mostly try to keep it funky.
Yeah.
And you helped us do that today. You and Brother Luther. Y'all have kept it funky for me, all right? Man, come back and see us again. Thank you. You've been listening to Funky Politics right here on the Kadukian Network.
DC and Doc Ward on Funky Politics. Riffin' on Jazz.
When two friends get together to kick it
about jazz, it's called Riffin' on Jazz.
Catch us Riffin' on Jazz every week right here on your favorite broadcast or podcast platforms.
Riffin' on Jazz on the Kadzookian Network. Kadzookian! DC.
We like to get a little funky on this show.
And Doc Ward.
Is it real or is it funky?
Funky Politics.
Back at you right here on Funky Politics, powered by the Kadzookian Network. I'm DC, sitting along with this education correspondent man, brother name, Renaissance man of the, I won't say of the ages.
Thank you.
I'm just going to put up 2019. And that ain't here yet. But anyway, Luther Mercer. And man, let me tell you,
yes, sir.
A show, man.
Yeah, it was powerful. It was powerful.
Dr. Christopher Emdin, and what he said, and you know, and I knew he was going to do it because I've heard this guy speak before. Mm-hmm. He connected with me because he said, even though sometimes we have people in our classrooms who are teaching our children who look just like us, if they've had experiences, negative experiences, and they don't try to put those away when they're trying to teach these children, they're going to project those same negative experiences on their child.
Absolutely.
What do we do, man?
Well, I mean, I think he gave us a roadmap, and people, everyone who was listening, I definitely think we need to go check out some of his books that he mentioned. But the idea that where we are now is where we are replicating a system of destruction. And he even mentioned Carter G. Speaking about this years ago, miseducation, and that we're still in this same point where they're saying we know the answers to how to educate a community of color, but yet refuse to do it.
Probably because if we change that narrative, if we did something different, somebody's going to lose out on something over
somebody.
Here on that side. Maybe the same folks that's been perpetuating the same system, you think?
Absolutely.
I don't know. I'm just
saying.
Right. Let me tell you something.
Yes, sir.
Always, right here on Funky Politics, we always keep it real.
That's
we
right.
keep it right. You know, we always got to keep it funky on this show right here. Funky Politics, powered by the Kadzookia Network.
Thank you, brother.
Recorded at Kadzookian Studio, directed, produced, recorded, and distributed by Kadzookian.